is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting?
Good morning, everyone. Show me that you're having a great morning by giving me a big smile. Show me that teeth, choir. Come on. Good job. Bob, let me see it. Okay, good. All right, welcome, everyone, to Williams. And if you're a visitor, double welcome you get, and you get to do something fun. Turn to the back of your bulletin, and there's a little flappy sheet of paper. It also rips out, but we would love for you to get a pen and just write the information down about yourself so we can get to know you better and just have a record of your visit. Now, before I go over and highlight a few things in the bulletin, I have some beautiful ladies that are going to do the same as well. They're going to highlight a few things going on. Gina, Miss Celia, and Miss Kay. So if y'all could just come in that order, that would be great.
Thursday evening, save the date at 6:30, ladies and girls. We're going to have a night of worship and fellowship, praise, and Bible study called Come to the Well. It is based on a song. I don't know if you've heard it from Casting Crowns, The Well. It's an awesome song. It just goes right to the heart of the matter, and this is... Of all the times that I've gotten up and asked you to come, this one is really something that I am asking you to come. I believe that you will truly leave here changed. It's changed me just with this study. Jennifer, that y'all heard sang a few weeks ago, is going to sing that song for us. She's learned that song plus a couple other things, and y'all heard her sing, so I don't have to say any more about that. But I hope to see you here at 6:30 Thursday evening. Come through the back entrance like before, or the front entrance instead of the side entrances. And we'll have some dessert and coffee after, if y'all have dinner before you come. And then we'll have some dessert and coffee. But young girls, hope to see you here. All right, thanks. God bless.
I just want to give another JCOC update. I know we love those, and so that we can find out what's going on and who we're helping. We had our meeting after the first quarter, and just want to point out that they have decided to only take new linens and new clothes, new children's clothes, due to some problems they've had. And the letter carriers, who we appreciate so much for doing this every year, is having their food drive on May 12th. It's on a Saturday. But once they leave the sack in your mailbox, you can do it any time that week. They'll pick it up, not just Saturday. And back to school will begin the end of July through the 1st of August, you know, for the back to school things, if you want to take something there. And the JSU auctioneers class auction for the JCOC that they do every year is in August. So if anybody has anything that's a good auction item, might bring some money for them, you know, be sure and donate it. Keep that in mind. And a shout out for the BCM for what they do every year of donating 12 hours of collecting food. They go to specific places, and then they clean the center. How awesome is that? So shout out to them. And the amount paid by Project Share, which we've talked about before, was over $5,000. That's just check that on your Alabama Power bill. And it just goes to a good cause. And I know we've all wondered before where that goes, but it goes locally, so great. And the last thing would be, what we want to hear is how many families they served the first quarter, and that would be 499 families. 57 of those families were new. And that makes the total of like over 1,200 people. So thanks for all you do, and please keep the JCOC in your prayers.
I would just like to remind everybody that on May 18th, from 10 to 5, we're going to have a health fair here in the CMC. The health fair is going to be a bigger health fair. The senior students came and did just a blood pressure screening with the devotional group 1 week. This is going to be totally different than that. We're going to have RMC here. We're going to have Jacksonville Medical Center here. We're going to have the health department here. So we're going to have vision hearing screenings. We're going to have pneumonia vaccines. We're going to have blood testing. Please, please, please take one of the flyers from the back and help dispense it to your neighbors, because the more people I have here, the better. I need to have 200. So please help me get the crowd out that day, because the rural health program from UAB is supposed to be sending residents to be the medical referral, and they're supposed to listen, you know, if something comes up abnormal on the sheet, instead of us having to send you to your doctor, there's supposed to be a doctor here that day to help look at you and check you over. So please, everybody, pass the word out. This is for us as well as for our neighbors. And if you know someone that goes to one of the other churches in the neighborhood, please take a flyer and ask your next door neighbor that goes to that church to make an announcement, so that we can get everybody in the community. The goal for this, we had planned this way before the tornadoes ever started. We started planning to have a health fair for the community, because there was so many people in the area that were a little bit underserved. So we really want to reach out and get those people in too. So if you can help us to reach them, I'm trying. Maybe you'll hear it on the radio. Maybe you'll see it on Channel 24. I'm trying to get the announcements out I've even asked 3340 to run an announcement. So hopefully y'all will see some announcements about this. But word of mouth is the best advertising ever. So if you can help us to get your neighbors to come, I'd appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ladies. Yay, now it's my turn. All right, everybody open up your bulletins. I want to hear them. Okay, good. That sounds great. All right, as you can see, we have evening worship tonight at 6 o'clock in here. Then after that, we're going to move to the Fellowship Hall, our CMC, and have a good little celebration send-off for Alex and Blake. Guys, y'all wave. You can't see Blake, but you might can see Alex. He's just smiling. Blake's up to, yeah, he's up top in the little hole up there. But we were asking that you bring some goodies to munch on tonight, some snack foods for our fellowship, and that will be after the service tonight. Wednesday night we have service at 6:30, but if you are hungry before then, you can come at 5:30 and eat some hoagies, sandwiches, this Wednesday night. And that will be at 5:30. Everyone, look here, I have a little flower. As you know, next Sunday is Mother's Day. Now, the Girl Scouts who meet here in our church building on Tuesdays are doing a little fundraiser for breast cancer research. So if you would like to do this and help them out, this is, I believe, $1, and you would get one of these little flowers and put your mother's name in honor of her or in memory of her. And the girls are going to set them out all around our church building in our little flower pot areas. Flower beds. So it's a really good call. So if you would like to do that, see Peggy in her office after the service this morning, and she'll have a flower for you. And also just know that there's some things in the insert here. The youth fundraiser, which is the Rent a Youth, if you would like to participate in that, see me after church to fill out a little form so we can get you started on that. And just know that if you're a graduate, if you've graduated from college in the past year and you want to be recognized in a couple of weeks, please let us know. Call the church office. And one last thing, June 11th through the 14th, which is the second week in June, is Vacation Bible School. So we're getting a head start on that. If you want to volunteer and help out for that, we'll need you this Wednesday in the choir room at 6 o'clock for a quick meeting. Any volunteers this Wednesday? Alrighty. So now we're going to have a contest. Who can hug the most people this morning? Okay, so ready? Go. I'm going to win.
I lose.
Our scripture call to worship this morning is from 2 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter and the 17th verse. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom.
Well, good morning. Well, I'm ready for worship. I don't know about y'all. 7 days at Disney World makes 1 week. Think about it. I'm ready for worship. And we got two folks that, listen, they came all the way from Missouri to worship with us today. The McPherson family, raise your hand. Give them a hand. It's soon as this church is over, you give him a Williams greeting. He's a photographer for the baseball team. So after church, he's going to be taking a picture of me in a baseball uniform. Going to send it to Missouri. Tell him I'm a 72-year-old pitcher for Jackville State. Welcome, my friends, and God bless you. This is the day the Lord hath made. We can, we will rejoice and be glad in it. Number 590, this is the day. 590, you stand with us, please, as we sing. Come on, let me hear you. General Shepherd. If we ever need him, need him now. 458. The name of Jesus, 112. Jesus, Jesus, name above all names. 112. You join us. What a worship song.
Oh, prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Psalms 23:5-6.
Providing daily bread for more than 100 families per week, the Family Food Pantry reaches out to a diverse population, including Bosnian refugees, who now call St. Louis home. Bosnian-speaking Pastor Sasa Zivanov and his wife, Mayor, CBF field personnel, attempt to meet the physical and spiritual needs of this community, confronting prejudice, mistrust, and misinformation, along with historical, cultural, and religious roadblocks. Mira and Sasha build relationships and share the gospel. Measuring their success in connections and in building trust, their ministry now includes coordinating mission teams to serve and encourage churches in their home country. One of their important connections is with their encourager church, Kirkwood Baptist in St. Louis.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You know, there's an old saying that says it's better to keep your mouth shut and be thought a fool than to open it and remove all doubt. Well, I opened my mouth and told Nikki that sometime I'd be glad to do the children's message. Guess what? Well, you know, we've talked a lot in the last year about the tornado that hit here, haven't we? Well, you know, I can remember a long time ago, because it was a long time ago when I was a little boy, but a long time ago in school, we'd have a fire drill. Have you ever had a fire drill?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, in our school, they'd ring the bell 3 times, and that meant everybody line up and get outside. And you stayed out there until the bell rang 2 times, meant everything was clear and you could come back in. Now, if they were looking for a tornado, they rang the bell 4 times. And you went to a room in the middle of the school that they had told you about, and you did the duck and cover. Do you know what duck and cover is?
Yeah.
Yes, I thought you might. Well, they did the duck and cover. And then when everything was clear, rang the bell 2 times, and everybody went back to place. But when you did the tornado thing, the teachers all had to have a flashlight because they were afraid the electricity might go out. And so you had to have a flashlight to see what was going on. Well, it's important to be prepared like that, isn't it? To know how to avoid trouble. Jesus told a story about 10 bridesmaids who were going to be in a big wedding. And their first job was to greet the bridegroom when he came. And the bridegroom was late coming, and it was dark night. And they had to go out and greet him with their lamps burning. And they had to stand out there and wait with their lamps burning till the bridegroom came. But Jesus told that 5 of them were careful and brought some oil to go in their lamp in case the oil they had burned out. And they would put some more oil in there and keep the lamp burning. But the other 5 weren't too bright. And you know what they did? They forgot their oil. And so what happened? The lamps went out, didn't they? And they said, oh, we've got to go get some more oil for the lamps. And so they ran off, and while they were gone, guess what happened? The bridegroom came. And so the 5 who had been prepared and put the oil in the lamp were able to go in with the bridegroom. And you know what they did? When they all got inside, they locked the door. And what happened to those other five? They were left out in the cold, weren't they? Because they weren't prepared. Now, the Bible tells us that Jesus is coming back one day, and we are to be prepared for His coming. And you know how we prepare ourselves for Jesus coming? By asking Him to come into our hearts and say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart and live in my heart, so when you come back to get me, I'll be prepared. And we all want to do that, don't we? Let's pray together. Lord, thank You for these wonderful boys and girls. Thank You for the knowledge that You're coming back someday to claim us. And we pray that each one of them will let Jesus come into their hearts, that they'll be prepared in Your name. Amen. Thank you so much. You're a wonderful group.
Children, it's a great story. It's not a story. It's true. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Number 97, we're going to stand and do all four stanzas. All four stanzas. Join us, please, as we sing. God. Hope you're experiencing that love today. Let's stand for the doxology, please. Praise God.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
It's so good to see you this morning because we're right on time or a little bit late. I will not say all that I'd wanted to say to you in the beginning, but I'll say a couple of things. One is I am grateful that you have asked me to be your interim pastor. I'm humbled by the experience and depending heavily on the Lord for what I can do here, but I'll also be depending on you. As you've noticed, I've asked Peggy to publish both of my telephone numbers in case you need me, And I'll be out here probably most of the time on Tuesday and Thursday mornings, or if you need me at another time, all you have to do is call me. Now, let me tell you my philosophy. I had a whole lot rather you call me any time of the day or night and tell me you need the pastor than to find it out second or third hand. That makes me a little bit unhappy. So if there's anything going on that I need to know about, anybody that's sick or any other problem, you need to let me know. And that's the reason I said publish my telephone numbers. So I'm counting on that, and I'm looking forward to working with you. One other thing I need to say, I have been coming to this church for now on to 30 years. That doesn't mean I know all of you by name. It means I know you by face. I can recognize you. But you may need to tell me who you are several times, and then I'll try to remember. And I can do that pretty well after a while, but you help me out, and don't be upset if I call you the wrong name or if I don't even know your name. Just help me to learn, and we'll all be better off. Thank you so much. From the second chapter of the book of the Acts, beginning with verse 42, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. This is God's word for today. Everyone would like to belong to a great church. The only problem is we confuse the meaning of that term. Because of the radio and TV and other media, we say great church when we mean mega church. The size of a church does not determine its greatness. We can look at the New Testament church to determine true greatness. The book of Acts is the story of the first 30 years of the Christian church. It shows us how the church in its infancy was on fire for Jesus Christ. It shows us what a truly great church should be. The first thing we might notice about the early church, which characterizes a great church, is a hunger for the Word of God. Verse 42 tells us that the early church devoted itself to the apostles' teaching. We know that the Holy Spirit spoke through the apostles, and much of this was written down to become what we know as the New Testament. In addition, the apostles based much of their message on the Old Testament. So when the people of the early church devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, they were devoting themselves to the Word of God. Isn't it strange how little many Christians today hunger for the Word of God? Getting together for the study of God's Word is neglected by too many people today. Rather, we merely want to attend a worship service where we wish to be entertained by the pastor. This certainly does not reflect a hunger for the Word of God. The early church reflected the words of Jesus, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they will be filled." They wanted to know God's will and purpose. They wanted to know how to live the full Christian life and knew they could not do it without a word from God. In like manner, the church today will never be a great church unless there is a genuine hunger for God's Word. We are so much more fortunate than the early church. They had to take a chance in getting together to hear the Word of God from the apostles. They had little access to the Word of God. Today, every one of us has at least one copy of the Scripture. In addition, if we seek to understand it better, if we wish, by having God's Word in several translations. But the question is, do we take advantage of that opportunity and spend time in God's Word? Our church will never be a great church unless it is a congregation steeped in God's Word. The second characteristic of the early church, which still is applicable today, is that they were devoted to the fellowship. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. The lesson here is that a great church cares for each other. Obviously, these people loved fellowship together. Not only did they meet regularly together for worship, they had a joyful fellowship together. Notice that they shared all that they had. Many of the early Christians were from among the poorest people. Others lost much of what they had because they confessed Christ. So those who had been blessed with worldly goods often liquidated them to share with others who were not as fortunate. I submit to you that is genuine Christian fellowship and concern. In addition, we are told that they opened their homes for fellow Christians to come in and share what God was doing. Interestingly enough, I have learned from my reading that truly successful churches are following that pattern today. Many couples will open their homes for fellowship and Bible study with their neighbors, reaching out to people who might not at that point come to the church building. People respond better to genuine fellowship, and many people out of these home groups will accept Christ and often identify with the church. You are aware that too many times we're looking out only for ourselves. First, we limit our fellowship to those like us. We only feel comfortable entertaining and sharing with people from our social status and who have the same values as we do. We forget that the Holy Spirit can change people to what they need to be. Of course, the most dangerous part of it all is that the Holy Spirit may change us. In addition, we share only from our access. If we have been blessed abundantly with this world's goods, we do not mind sharing some of them. But we really don't like the idea of sacrificing. Who knows when we may need what we give away? Do you suppose that God is not capable of replenishing what we give away? Bob McLeod took me on a tour of his marvelous ministry on Friday and told me how God had supplied their needs. I was impressed with the idea behind it. Freely you have received, freely give. The pattern reaches all the way back to the New Testament. We need to follow that philosophy in our giving and living. In addition, we are often too slow to open our homes to others because that is just too much trouble. Forgetting, as I have said, that there are those who need the gospel but will not darken the door of a church building. Remember the words of Jesus, "By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, that you have love for one another." There it is. It's not great church buildings or elaborate worship services. It's not great entertainment in the name of worship. It is simply the love of God flowing through us to others that can make a great church. It was the Apostle John who caught on to this idea as he said, "Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Since God so loved us, we ought to love one another." I'm not suggesting to you that this is easy, but I am suggesting to you that it is God's way to reach others with the gospel. The great church is one that is consumed by the fellowship of hearts that are filled with the love of God in Christ. If we want our church to be a truly great church, we will open our hearts, our doors, and the doors of the church to those in need of whatever we can offer. According to our text, another characteristic of a great church is that it is committed to worship. In verse 42, the breaking of bread probably means the Lord's Supper. Whenever we observe this ordinance, we are observing the central act of worship for the Christian church. Let us never consider it commonplace. Let us bow our heads and hearts in worship for the love of God exemplified in the sacrifice of Christ. This same verse tells us further that they devoted themselves to prayer. The great church recognizes the importance and power of prayer. I'm always glad when people will request prayer in our time from the church. The question is, do we really believe in the power of prayer? Do we honestly devote ourselves regularly to prayer? If we are a great church, we will. And by the way, if we promise to pray for people or their requests, we will be faithful to do just that. We are further told that the early church was filled with awe. In other words, they were amazed at what God was doing in their midst. As wonderful things happened, they recognized it was not because of anything they had done or were doing. Rather, it was the blessing of God on them. Are we ever amazed at the power and action of God in our midst? I am afraid that too often we do not give God credit for what He is doing. Or worse still, we take God's actions and blessings for granted. The scripture says that they were awestruck by God's actions, and because they were, they spent time praising Him. How much praise do we give God for His amazing grace in our midst? I've heard you recognize the greatness of God in your midst. I hope there will never come a time when you take the goodness of God for granted. Let us always stand in awe of the greatness and goodness of God. We're told that the early church met regularly in the temple courts. In other words, they recognized the importance of corporate worship. The great church has a congregation which still recognizes the importance of corporate worship. It is so easy to feel that we do not have to let worship interfere with other special things we want to do as a family or as individuals. After all, the church will be there when we get back. What does the church today know about worship? Is it alive or static? Is that a let's let every part of the worship service speak to us. Do we sincerely band together for prayer? Is that a genuine part of worship? Do we come to worship expecting God to do something? By the Holy Spirit, are we filled with the spirit of awe and reverence? Where is our spirit of praise? The great church is a worshiping church where people look forward to gathering each Sunday to praise God for the miracles He is doing in our midst. Last but certainly not least, the great church is concerned about outreach. We are told that wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles, but we must understand that this was because of the people's attitude. They undergirded the apostles in prayer. At the risk of sounding repetitive, I must say that we too must undergird the ministry and mission of the church in prayer. Otherwise, it will go nowhere. This early church showed excitement over God's actions. They doubtless told people about what God was doing. Though it was sometimes dangerous to gather for worship or spread the gospel, they did so with much enthusiasm and joy. We are not going to be persecuted for excitement over God's actions today. But then we don't show much excitement, do we? We would rather quietly assemble and go through our worship and then depart to our regular life. Here is something strange. The scripture tells us they enjoyed the favor of all the people. In other words, they had a good image in the community. When the people witnessed their love for one another and their ministry to those in need, they were impressed and wanted to know what made these people that way. People outside the church are still impressed by that kind of lifestyle. The church needs to have a good image in the community. You have built that image. Never let it die. The text ends by telling us that the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. In other words, they received the fruits of evangelism. God was doing the saving, but they had to be ready to receive and include them. Unless God knows that we want the church to grow stronger by reaching people outside the church, we may not see Him adding others to the church. The question is, are we concerned about outreach? In other words, is there a clear channel for God's action in our community because of our attitude? Are we bathing the work of God in genuine prayer? Do we show excitement over God's grace? Are we actively sharing the gospel with people and encouraging them to respond? Do we have a good image in the community? Are we receiving the fruits of evangelism? The great church is the one that is always concerned about outreach to the community. What is a great church? A spiritually growing, fellowshipping, worshiping church. But Bob, you haven't said anything about the physical plant of the church. You haven't mentioned the TV ministry. You haven't mentioned the great offerings and the multiple staff. You're right, I haven't. Because these are not characteristics of a great church, just a big church. A great church may be 50 members on Route 3 to Egg, Tennessee. A great church is one empowered by the Holy Spirit and filled with individuals committed to letting Christ live through them. Do you want to be a member of a great church? It's up to you. Let's pray. Lord, we would be a great church, not that we would be bragged on, not that people would see that, but that people would see Jesus and come to Him. We pray now that You will work in our time together in Jesus' name. Amen. We come now to our time of decision. First and foremost, always, is the decision to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. If you have not done that, that is the life's most urgent matter, and we invite you to come today. If you'd like to unite with this church in some way that she receives members, she'll be happy to receive you. Or any other decision that the Lord is laying on your heart, this is your opportunity as we stand together and sing hymn numbered 497. Thank you so much for being here today. I'll look forward to seeing you at 6 o'clock tonight. Donna's going to come and lead our benediction.